All right, Father, we thank you for glory, for blessings, for all of your provisions and goodness for us. Thank you, Father, for this day. Thank you for every good and every perfect gift.
All from above, from the Father of lights, with whom there is no mirror but this, by the shadow of turning. Lord, you are the strength of my life. You are the light of my salvation. Lord, we thank you. Hallelujah. You've begun the good work within us. And you who have begun the good work, you shall continue to perform it. Lord, our eyes are upon you. You're the author. You're the finisher of our faith. And we thank you, Lord, for all that you've done. Thank you, God, for delivering us from the power of darkness and translating us into the kingdom of your dear Son, in whom we have remission. We have redemption through your blood and the remission of our sins. Father, we thank you today, hallelujah, that we are complete, that we've been given power and authority over all power of the enemy. Nothing by no means shall hurt us. Father, we thank you that we can do all things through Christ that strengthens us. Greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. As he is, so are we in this world. And we can, hallelujah, overcome because of our testimony and the blood of the Lamb. Oh God, Satan has been defeated. His power has been broken. He's been dethroned. He's a defeated foe. And you have given us power over all power of the enemy. Nothing by no means shall hurt us. Lord, we thank you because all authority has been given to you. Yes, and that authority has been delegated, hallelujah, to all of us that have received you as Lord and Savior. We give you the praise and the glory. Tonight, and we thank you, Lord, for beginning the good work within us. And you have begun the good work within us. You shall continue to perform it. And have our eyes upon you. You're the author, you're the finisher. Hallelujah. And we thank you, Lord, because you are for us and you are with us. And you've given us all things that pertain unto life. Jesus' name, the name that we worship and honor and delight in and rejoice in, the name above every name, that is the name of Jesus. We give you the glory and the praise in Jesus' name. Everybody say in Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name. Amen. All right. We just want to call your attention to the scripture that we read Sunday. I just wanted to kind of focus on motivating and inspiring you to reach out, and thank God for all of you that are in the mode of reaching out. Just after talking to one woman, she's got here tonight, she had some influences. She said that she was bringing two people Sunday, and this is what we want to begin to do. I think everybody ought to be able to inspire, motivate, or to encourage somebody to come to hear the word. Amen. Come to hear the word. So, you know, I don't think much of a believer if they can ever persuade anybody to believe what they believe or to come and hear what they are hearing and listening to. That's a kind of a poor representation of what you are standing for. So I don't think anybody has an excuse. The resting period is over. It's time for us to get back, get about my father's business. So we just want to remind you, we're going to expect her to buy the month of November. Between now and November, this month, the rest of this month, and next month, we're going to ask everybody to be instrumental in getting somebody to show up and to come. And I'm going to have to ask you personally, have you got anybody here yet? Amen. All right, who were the two people with you y'all Sunday? Brother Dunn and Sister Norma?
Daughter and son and daughter.
Oh, wow.
And grandchildren.
Yes. And grandchildren. Okay. All right, that's mighty nice. You got anybody else you think we can get to come?
Yeah, we're working on
it. All right, you're working on it. How many saints are working on somebody? Okay. Okay, I want to inspire you, encourage you to really put all that you have into this this time. I think that we've have spoken to the body of Christ in the past to get involved in winning souls, but this time I think it's going to be a lot different, and I just think that we're going to catch on and we're going to be moved, and God is going to give us a passion for the ministry of reconciliation. I want you to turn to the scripture that we focused on Sunday, and I'm going to go a little further. Deuteronomy 10, verse 12 and 13. The reason why I want you to focus on that scripture is because all of us are held accountable, and we are going to be responsible for a dispensation of the gospel. In other words, this is the reason why God has called you. This is the reason why Jesus became sin for us. This is the reason why God sent Jesus to make it possible for us to actually to be purged and to be cleansed from our iniquities so that we can be zealous of good works. And that is the main responsibility that we have after we are saved. We're saved by faith, but after we're saved, God expects that faith to be mixed with works. Faith without what? Works is dead. And anybody that's going to be inactive, that's not going to be involved in the Lord's work and carrying out the will of God and really fulfilling their call as a believer, as we see in the parable of the talent and the pound, they were cast into outer darkness. They were unprofitable servants. And what that's based on is that the Bible says, he that knoweth to do good and don't do it, to him is what? Sin. And there's another scripture shows that God holds us accountable for works. And, you know, be careful to maintain good works. The Bible says we are created for that particular purpose, with his workmanship, created for the purpose of producing works. And God expects us to walk in those works that he has called us to do. Let me just give you those scriptures that will kind of help you to bring things into focus before we read Deuteronomy 10, because that is the thing that God is requiring of us in Deuteronomy 10, 12, 13. Okay, let me give you those scriptures. James 4:17, therefore to him who knows to do good and does not do it, to him it is sin. James 4:17. So there is a sin of commission, there's a sin of what? Omission. And the sin of omission is just as severe as the sin of commission. Now the servant that did not do the Lord's will and give his talent, that didn't do anything. In other words, he was just totally in acting, he was, he had dead faith, his faith that did not result in any type of activity of any kind, and any type of faith that does not result in activity of any kind is a dead faith. It is empty, worthless, and insincere. And that type of response, so we don't want to fall in that category that we are not actually walking in those good works that God has called us to walk in. Let's look at another scripture, Malachi 3:18. It says, then ye shall again discern between the righteous and the wicked, between one who serves God and one who does not serve him. Those are two scriptures that you can hang your hat on because it distinctly reveals to us that God expects us to be doers of the word and not hearers only. He expects us to carry out the commission, the responsibilities that he has been, that he has assigned us. So just kind of meditate on those scriptures because these are sins of omission which are no less serious than the sins of commission. And whenever we fail, fall short of not doing what God says to do, although we don't be guilty of some sin, committing some sin, things that we fail to do are also are considered as grave sins as well. And in the parable, one person, in Matthew 25, he was cast into outer darkness. He was totally rejected. All right. Let me give you one more scripture in this regard. Proverbs 3:27. Another scripture that is very similar to the scripture, the two scriptures I just gave you in James 4:17, Malachi 3:18. It says, withhold not good from them to whom it is due, when it is in the power of thine hand to do it. So I gave you three scriptures, and these scriptures are emphasizing the fact that sins of omission are no less serious than the sins of commission. And God expects something out of us for all of the time and all of the opportunities and all of the gifts and talents and things that he has bestowed upon us. We are being held accountable, and all of us are on probation, and God is just watching, and I mean, he's determined that he's going to be counted worthy to serve him. I mean, who's going to be counted worthy to serve him willingly throughout eternity? And he's looking for obedience, and he's looking for people that will serve him willingly. Amen. Okay, let's look at Deuteronomy, and we're going to Deuteronomy 10, verse 12 and 13. Let's all read it together. What does it say? And now what, Israel? What doth the Lord thy God require of thee but to fear the Lord thy God, to walk in all of his ways, and to love him, and to what serve the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul. Verse 13, to keep the commandments of the Lord and his statutes which I command thee this day for thy good. Okay, now the Lord requires, first of all, for us to fear him. Now, what does fear the Lord mean to you? Fear the Lord. That being scared of God? Okay, what does that mean?
Respect.
Okay, respect. What else?
Reverence.
All right. Anybody else? Okay. So it can be explained or broken down many ways, but it's a wholesome dread of displeasing God. All right, so when a person comes to a place where they just really hate to violate things that God has really told us to do, how many of those kind of people do we have? All right, do we have any among us? All right, a wholesome bread of what? Displeasing God. Okay, so is it possible to walk in all of his ways and to love him? To love him means to what? Obey him, or to what? Do what he has commanded you to do. And to serve the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy what? Soul. You know, this is very consistent with the New Testament admonition. It says, whatever you do, do it what? Heartily, as unto the Lord, giving thanks to the Lord Jesus in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Giving thanks to God. How many remember the song that we used to sing, Speak to One Another? With songs, hymns, and spiritual songs, always giving thanks to God, the Father, for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, so is it possible to walk in all of God's ways and to fulfill these particular commands that we are seeing in verses 12 and 13? Is that possible for us to do? The things that God is requiring of us, can we actually do that and really walk pleasingly for God? Is it possible?
Yes.
Okay, somebody give me a scripture that will back that up. Alright. Alright, there's a lot of scriptures, alright? Let us know. I can do all things through what Christ that strengthens me. Let me show you another scripture in the New Testament over in Titus 2. Titus 2. Okay, Titus 2 is for the grace of God. Okay, now, under the Old Covenant, it was not possible for the old patriarchs and prophets really to live as we live today. They had to live according to the law. Right, but the thing is that they were able to please God. Some of them were able to please God, but it was a covenant that God had given them that operated by faith. And these were called men of faith. And they walked by faith, and they did not walk by what? Sight. And they didn't please God by works, but they did please God by what? Faith. So without faith, it's impossible what? To please God. Amen. And the grace of God is the thing that has appeared today that enable us to go up to a different level. And as we begin to walk in faith and to walk in love, we can actually fulfill all of God's requirements. And actually, Titus 2, verse 11 and 12 kind of bears this out. And also Romans 8, verses 2 and 3, because the scripture says that what the law couldn't do, that it was weak in the flesh, but God sending forth his Son in the what? Likeness of sinful flesh, and what? Condemned sin in the flesh, so that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not according to the what? Flesh, but according to what? The Spirit. So we can walk in the Spirit today by faith through the grace of God. And that's the thing that elevates us to a higher place, higher position, where we are not under the dominion of sin and where we can do all things through who? Christ, that what? Strengthens us. So that really places us in a position where we can actually experience, amen, the grace of God on three different levels, okay? Verse 11, okay? It says, "For the grace of God that bringeth salvation may appear unto all men, teaching us that denying what? Ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live what? Soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world." Okay, now, let's look at that. The grace of God that bringeth salvation, that is grace that brings what? Salvation, which means that is the first work of grace in our life, salvation. We are delivered from the power of darkness. Satan's dominion over our lives are what? Broken. And we become new creations in Christ. And as we begin to grow in grace and begin to grow in knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, then we get to the point where we can experience a renewing of our minds. And we don't have to be conformed to the world, but we can be transformed by the renewing of our minds. So God has enough grace to deliver us or to cleanse us and to redeem us from all iniquity. Amen. And that is God's objective. So the grace of God that brings salvation is the first work of grace. Amen. And then the second thing that grace does, it also teach us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. So not only grace brings salvation, but grace makes us overcomers in this life. It gives us power and dominion over our what? Flesh. Over sin, over Satan, over the forces of darkness. Amen. We don't have to yield our members as instruments of unrighteousness to sin. Amen. Self-restraint and self-control and dominion over yourself is one of the key components of the work of grace. We call that standing grace. We call that sanctifying grace. We call that cleansing grace. So God does more than save us and leave us helpless in this world where Satan can still rule and reign and dominate over us, but he gives us power, amen, to overcome Satan in the realm of our what? Flesh, in the realm of our what? Our spiritual life. The Bible says, "There's therefore now no condemnation." Amen. To them who are in Christ Jesus. See, grace teaches us how to live free and separated from sin. Then grace turns around and gives you what? The power, the ability. Amen. It gives you power and authority over what? All power of the enemy. That's what Jesus came to do. Not just to save you, but to deliver you from the sin of this present world. Amen. These promises are given, amen, to redeem us from the corruption that's in the world. So we can live an overcoming life. So the objective of living an overcoming life, a victorious life, amen, where we just say that it teaches us to live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present. Why is it important for us to live soberly, godly, and righteously in this present world? What is the main objective that God is saying here that we need to live a life that's free and separated from the world and the flesh? All right. Why is it that? Why is that important? Okay, Sister Sharon said, because if we don't be that example, if we don't live a life of restraint,
If we don't live an overcoming life, then your testimony is going to be what paralyzed. You're not going to be able to what to convince and to convict people. People always say, if I'm going to believe in your Redeemer, you're going to have to look. Sister Sharon said, Joe, I like the way you said it.
No, you said
it. Come on. How did you say that? All right. All right. If I'm going to believe in your Redeemer, you're going to have to look more redeemed yourself. So the Bible places a lot of emphasis on being a good example. You have to be a good example. You're the light of the world, city that sits on a hill. All right, that cannot be here. And then the Bible says, let your light so shine before men that they might see your good works and then what? Glorify your, the Father which is in heaven. So that's the only way people are going to see Christ. They're going to have to see Christ in you. They're not going to see Christ in the Bible by reading and getting their own revelation. They're going to have to see it through you. You're going to have to live the life, and then you're going to have to what? You're going to have to share the life. You're going to have to what? Speak to them concerning the things that Jesus has what? Done and provided for them. People will be impacted by your lifestyle, your good example, but that's not what the Bible, that's not the only criteria that people's salvation hinges on. It hinges on your life because, amen, if you don't have a life, it's not, they definitely not going to what? Listen to what you got to say. All right, but you got to be able to what? To share the hope of that's in you. You have to be able to share what God has what done for you. You have to be able to share what Jesus has what provided for you and how he has what delivered you, delivered them from the what power of darkness and has what defeated Satan and broken the dominion of spiritual death. Amen. Praise God. And actually, the things that Jesus has done for us, the Bible says, amen, calls those things precious promises. This is found in 2 Peter. And by these special promises, as according to 2 Peter, it says, 2 Peter chapter 1, these precious, great and precious promises, by these ye might be partakers of the divine nature. And that's the thing that God wants us to be partakers of. He wants us to be conformed to his image. He wants us to be just like Jesus. And that's holy, it's blameless, holy, undefiled, separate from sinners. Because that's the only type of character that actually can project Christ and represent Christ and actually be effective in convincing men that Jesus Christ is still alive today. Amen. Now, let's go back to Titus. I didn't quite finish that. That we see saving grace. Everybody just says saving grace.
Amen.
Now, sometimes when we think of grace, we only think about what? Saving grace. I was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Amazing grace. So, but the grace of God goes much further than just bringing salvation. It also goes, amen, the second step, which is to deliver us from the evil of this present world. In other words, it what? It delivers us from the power of our what? Flesh, the power of sin, the power of Satan, the power of darkness. And it breaks the dominion of sin from over our lives. So we don't have to continue in sin. That was the question Paul said. Shall we continue in sin? That grace may abound? God says what? No. Amen. He that is dead to sin, how shall we live? Amen. Praise God. Under the power of the control of sin. So the work of grace goes far beyond than salvation, saving us. I mean, our spirits, but it really delivers us from the power of our flesh, the power of sin, and the I can't help it spirit. People say, I can't help it. I just, my spirit is willing, but my what? Flesh is weak.
But that excuse has been eliminated. See, God says that He wants us to be in this world and to live a life of what? Restraint, a life of for sanctification. And He mentions is that denying what? Ungodliness and what? Worldly lust. That we should live what? Righteously, and what? Godly in this present world. Okay, let's see the rest of it there. Why is that so important? Looking for that blessed hope. Now, what does that mean? That all of us are looking for what? Jesus to come back. Amen. Jesus has gone away, and He's going to what? Come back. At the end of this age of grace, Jesus is going to come back, and He's going to what? He's going to take us to heaven with Him, and there we are going to give an account for the deeds that have been done in our bodies. We will stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Everybody say, the judgment seat of Christ. And we will give an account of all of the deeds and works that we have performed in our bodies. And that is the reason why the grace of God purges us and cleanses us, with our help, so that we can be zealous of good work and that we can be redeemed from all iniquity. Okay, that's what verse 14 said. I want you to read that with me. Who gave Himself for us that He might what? Redeem us from what? All right, some iniquity. All right, all iniquity, and purify unto Himself a what? Peculiar people, zealous of good works. Okay, so that scripture shows that we need to be zealous of good works. Let me just give you another scripture that focuses on good works, how important they are. And if you would read the first three chapters in Revelation, you will see that these overcomers that will be reigning with Christ throughout the millennium and through eternity, these are people that have overcome by the blood and the word of their testimony. These were the people that really overcame Satan, the flesh, the world, and sin. And so verse 26 of chapter 2 in Revelation says this, and he that overcometh, I want you to look at that, and he that overcometh and what? Keepeth my what? Works unto the what? End. To him will I give what? Power over the nations. And he shall what? Rule them with a rod of iron, as the vessels of a potter shall they be broken to shivers, even as I receive of my Father. Okay, so we're going to be judged, and we're going to be given responsibilities in the millennium reign of Christ. And throughout eternity, we're going to be serving Christ even after we leave the world scene here. And the level of trust and the level of responsibility that we will be given throughout the millennium reign and even throughout eternity will depend on our faithfulness and our commitment, amen, to serve Him down here, amen, in this life. So that Deuteronomy scripture is talking about what? Fearing the Lord, loving the Lord. I mean, in other words, obeying and what? Serving the Lord. All right, so serving the Lord with works. Now, what type of works are the Lord expecting out of us? Anybody have any idea what type of works the Lord is expecting out of us? Zealous of good works. So we need to know what type of works the Lord is expecting us to perform.
Mr. Farrell, look like you want to say something. Okay. Anybody got any idea? Okay. All right. These little fellas here. What y'all want to say? Okay. The scripture we just read, he wants to purge us and to cleanse us from all iniquity. And he wants us to get out of sin. Sin is committing stuff and what? Omitting stuff. And we're going to talk about that. We know that in terms of, Sister Hill mentioned souls, but souls is not just sinners out here that's lost. And I think that that's the area that very few people focus on here. And how many omissions, sins of omission are we guilty of? And the Bible says, withhold not good from them to whom it is good, when it's in the power of your hand, what? To do it. We that know to do good and to do it. That's one of the main areas that that God is holding us accountable. Can God trust us throughout eternity based on our faithfulness and commitment in this life? Can he trust us? Can he trust us with true riches in the life to come when he can't really trust us with precious souls that's perishing and dying all around us? I mean, let me just bring it home. I mean, people are right in the church. Now, we have people coming to church all the time. Back there, we have the Browns. Amen. And sometimes we don't even connect with people that, we don't even know the names. I didn't mean to say that. We've never, shown any interest in them. Now, could God trust us through with eternal responsibilities, true riches, when he can't trust us with people right in our midst that we have withhold good from them to whom it is due? Last night, I think that the brothers made a commitment. I mean, it was quite a few brothers here last night. We just got to do something if we want to, unless, the scripture says before the judgment seat of Christ, it's going to be if we build on gold, silver, and precious stones. All depends on what type of foundation. I mean, the type of foundation you build on will determine the type of responsibility that you will be able to exert during the millennium reign and throughout eternity. It's a long time to be in eternity and you have not been counted worthy of eternal responsibilities because of so many sins of omission and things that God has almost placed at your doorstep that you could do, and you withhold good from them to him, for to them that to whom it is due. I think it's very serious for us to know those that label among us and know people among us that God sent among us, that we can minister to, that we can encourage, that we can call, that we can help, that we can share the word. Many times when new people come, they don't know a whole lot about the Bible. I mean, they would welcome any type of exhortation or encouragement, or somebody that can rightly divide the word of God and encourage them. Okay, now are we playing the waiting game, the sitting game? We're just going to sit here until Jesus comes and just a little few folk that show up here, and we're going to be content with that? I think not. Brothers last night, amen, praise God, they talk like they're going to bring some souls in. Because I believe that this is very critical, because, see, here's the thing about it, is that you're either building on 1 Corinthians 3:11, 12, 13. You're either building on gold, silver, precious stone. Or you're building on what? Wood, hay, and what? Stubble. And wood, hay, and stubble is the works that you perform that you will not get any rewards for. They are works that you do. I mean, you try, amen, you hit and miss, you do a little something, but it's not of a quality that God can reward. And as a result of that, the rewards and the eternal consequences will not mount to the level where God can actually place you in responsive roles where you would be, you know, because some are going to be over so many cities, some are going to be over this, some are going to, you know, sit with him in the throne, some are going to be a pillar of the temple. It's all types of eternal responsibilities that God is going to delegate to a whole lot of people that have been faithful. Okay, Sister Hills wants to know the types of works that falls under the category of wood, hay, and stubble.
That would be the works that done in man one's flesh.
All right. Works done in one's flesh. I thought all works are done in the flesh. You mean in the power of one's own ability and wisdom only, I guess.
Not do you mean by that spiritual kinds of things or natural kinds of things? I wonder, you know, in math, you were a math teacher, fraction. Mm-hmm. Reduce this to the lowest term.
Okay.
Woods, hay, and stubble. What are those words that all?
Okay.
May I expound on what I was saying?
Okay.
So that would be the works that one does within, it has to do with pride. Just like I say, I did this in order to be admonished. In order to say, look what I did. Pride. Simple pride. Mm-hmm. Put it that way.
Okay. Works that's done that is not done for the glory of God, but for the glory of a person or to magnify, you know, person to magnify themselves in the flesh. Okay, Brother Lee, by the way, okay. I have something that's very good, Brother William. I really like that. Okay, we should examine our motives. Is the aim of our service to please ourselves for our satisfaction and glory, or do we sincerely seek to glorify Christ and to do his will? That's what Brother William was saying. So your motive, that's the thing that God looks for when he begins to evaluate the works that you have done on earth, because they're not going to stand the test of fire. Okay, was this work, was the aim of your service to please yourself? You know, many times people serve God, the Lord say, do this or do that, or praise in this way and all that. We just say, well, no, I'm not going to take all of that. I'm not going to. Scripture said, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Sometimes we just pick a pen around, and I mean, in a worship service, you'd be surprised of how much people actually give of themselves. And sometimes people don't give anything. They just look and observe, and, you know, stay on the sideline. They don't get enough.
So that's the category.
Yeah, please, yeah, not, see, the Bible says, whatever you do, doing what? Heartily, as unto the Lord, and not unto what? Men. So, we have to really do things for the what? For the glory of God, and not, you know, please ourselves, or to make it easy, you know, even in terms of, you know, most times, sharing and helping people, blessing people, and working with people, and ministering to people. That involves what? Sacrifice time, labor, prayers, a whole lot of things that's going to, what, take away some of the comfort that you have. But many times people don't understand the importance of what? Getting out of ourselves and getting in a realm where forget about our satisfaction and glory. You know, we're not to please ourselves, but we're to what? Please Him that who have what? Died for us and that rose again. Amen. This is the reason why Jesus didn't please Himself. Right? So we can't what? Please ourselves. So the main objective of all that we do is what? For the glory and the honor of what? The Lord. The Bible says, let no man boast in his what? Wisdom, no man in his might and his what? Riches. But let him that boast in the fact that I am the Lord and I'm the one that executes judgment and righteousness and all of these things. That's what the Lord delights in. So that's the first thing. Now, what do you do? I mean, you do it to be seen, you do it to be honored, you do it to feel good about yourself, or you do it to please men. That is the wrong what? Attitude, the wrong motive. And those works would be, I don't care how elegant they are, and I don't care how powerful, how much knowledge. Bible says knowledge puffs up. But you have to watch the spirit that you do things in. Because you can be what? Spinning your wheels and not what? Placing yourself in a position where you can what? Actually receive rewards, because those type of works are not going to what? Stand the test of fire. Okay. That's one area. Everybody got that? That was really good. I really, you need to be here more because you always have good ideas. You would be a great teacher. Okay, number two, we should examine ourselves on the points of obedience. Are we seeking to serve Christ according to the principles and methods revealed in the Word of God? Or are we fashioning our own forms of worship and service and then attaching to them the name of Christ and the titles and phrases of New Testament religion? In other words, are we really seeking to serve the Lord according to the Word? How many really trying to do it the way God wants it done? You know, how many believe that many times people just do it the way they feel like it should be done? And they are not really that determined to what serve God according to what the standards and the Word that He has what? He has actually laid down for us. Obedience, you know, is a big issue. And we have to obey God and seek to serve Him according, because you're going to be judged according to the Word. The Word is going to be our what? Standard of judgment. The Word of God is going to be the standard that God uses in order to judge us and to determine what nature of our works are. He's going to use the standard of what? The Word of God. So if He's going to use that standard, that means what? You better what? Make sure you what? You know the standard and you are what? Living according to the standard. And don't get shaky because walking in all of God's ways and, you know, living a life according to Titus 2, 11-12, the grace of God that brings salvation hath appeared unto all men, teaching us the denying ungodliness and unrighteousness, that we shall live righteously and ungodliness, rather, and we shall live righteously, godly, and soberly. That is possible through the what? The power of God. That is possible through the Spirit of grace. And you can't do it in the power of your human flesh. The scripture says, Romans 8:2, just turn there just for a moment, with the flesh, what for the law of the Spirit of life, I believe it is, in Christ Jesus, has made us free from the law of what? Sin and death. So there is a higher law than the law of sin that's operating in us. It supersedes the law of what? Sin and death. And if you walk in the Spirit and in the Word, then the righteousness of the law, whatever God is expecting, whatever is pleasing to God, will automatically will be what? Will actually what be manifested through your life. See, what the law couldn't do. Okay, let's read that. Let's read it and get the whole thing. Romans 8, 2. What does that say? Okay, for the law. Okay, read the next scripture. For what the law. So that what? The righteousness of the law might be what? Fulfilled in us who walk what? Not according to the what? Flesh, but after the Spirit. So the law, which represents our human efforts, that would never bring us to a point where we can what? Fulfill all of God's requirements. There is no way we can please God by doing things in the strength of our own what? Flesh. That's what the law represents, the attempt to please God by your human efforts. And you can't please God through your human efforts. You're going to have to what? Get in the Spirit. Okay, when we say get in the Spirit, that means what? Get into the Word. Right? Grace and peace will be multiplied through the knowledge of God. You got to know something. Faith works by what? Love, right? And without faith, it's impossible to please the Lord. And faith comes by what? Hearing. And hearing by what? The Word of God. So, the Word of God and through prayer, surrendering, yielding to God. See, one of the big issues in judgment, okay, we mentioned, your motives got to be right. You got to what? You got to serve God according to the principles that He has what revealed in His Word. And the third thing, we got to serve Him. We should examine ourselves in respect of power. Are we seeking to serve God in the inadequacy of our own carnal strength? Or have we been renewed and empowered by the Holy Spirit? If so, then we can say like Paul, to this end I also labor, striving according to his working, which works in me mightily. See, one of the big issues is that we have to serve God in the power of what? The Holy Spirit. In other words, you got to get in the Spirit realm and walk in the Spirit. And that means what? A life of what? Consecration. That's the reason why God wants us to, amen, praise God, to walk, the scripture says, in restraint. In other words, with control and subduing your body, putting your flesh under the dominion of the Word and the Spirit of God. So that is the objective of the Spirit of grace, to purge us, to cleanse us from what? All iniquity. Through a restraint of our physical body, through the Word, and through what? Walking in the Spirit. See, if we did what the Word says to do, we would have to have all of the battles and all of the problems and changes that we go through. For instance, the Bible says, speaking to yourselves in psalms, hymns, and what? Spiritual songs. Be filled with the Holy Spirit. Pray with all prayer. You know, and sometimes you have to what? Force people to what? To pray in the Spirit. And sometimes we're not consistent in prayer. And this is the thing that really causes us to kind of what? Start in the Spirit, and then we gradually begin to what? tried to what? Lapse back into the what? In the flesh. So the area that God will hold us accountable, and this is going to be a big area that God is going to bring to our attention, is the area of those who effectively control their flesh and succeed in overcoming sin, the works of the flesh, Satan and the book. In other words, how effective were you in overcoming the flesh? Everybody just think about that for a minute. See, he's going to hold you accountable for overcoming the flesh, because he has given you all of the tools, all of the what? All of the necessary equipment you need in order to what? To put Satan under your feet and to put your flesh down and to bring your flesh into what? Into the control of your human spirit. All right, so that's an area, overcoming the flesh. Now, why would God be so interested in you overcoming the flesh? Because if you don't overcome the flesh, you're not going to be that zealous of good works. You're not going to what? I mean, if a person is not living according to the word, they're not going to be concerned about souls. They're not going to be, you know, God, this church can fill up with people. They'll never make any effort to what? To meet them, reach out, help them, bless them, minister, call them, build a relationship. And that's something that comes automatically when you really begin to have the right motive, when you really have a sincere desire to please God, and when you really try to do things in the power of what? The Holy Ghost. Amen. I think that there will be an awakening, and that you will begin to develop a concern about what? People, not only the lost, but those among us, and those that that are actually in our congregation. Many are in distress. Many are going through changes. Many have challenges that they need somebody to what? To pray with them on. And many of them need the Word of God rightly divided, open up to them. You know, today we were talking in the Bible class, and we were just saying that that we really need volunteers, people that will help and assist in helping people on a one-on-one basis. Because you have new people like Sharita. I imagine she could use some encouragement. She's going through a whole lot of challenges. Is that right? All right, she comes to prayer. And but how many calls do you get of people that show any concern about you? This is the same type of thing that we gotta really keep in mind. How interested are we in people, period? Are we just interested mainly in ourselves? Maybe we can just let y'all talk, or we can just let y'all go for a minute. I think that we can cultivate a real passion and a real interest in people, so that we can really begin to edify the body of Christ. And I think that this is something that we really need to begin to focus on, because people will not run away from love. If people show interest, if I'm getting some calls, if somebody shows some concern about me, helping me, blessing me, encouraging me, I feel that, amen, people are going to want to show up again when they come into our midst. Okay, so how many see the reason why some are building on what? The wood, paint, and what? Stubble. There will not be any enduring rewards based on the inferior quality of the works that are performed in the flesh. Amen. So we just need to remember that the admonition to to do all of these things that the commitment to our responsibility for the souls of others. You know, that's just one aspect that the judgment will be based on. It won't be just souls entirely, but that's going to be one of the major issues that God will bring into judgment, because that is the primary call that we have, responsibility that we have. All right, endurance and suffering and hardship for Christ and the gospel's sake. You can see why that would be an issue as well, because if you're not willing to suffer, the level and the degree of your ability will be what? Severely impacted by that. If we suffer with them, Christ is going to what? He's going to actually, amen, be manifested in our life. I mean, the power, the anointing, the glory, amen, is going to follow the obedience and the suffering and going through hardships. All right, I don't want to do a whole lot, but how many of you kind of get the message tonight? Is that we have a very serious call, very serious, and God is going to bring into judgment every work along with every secret thing. And believe me, you don't want to be in, go out through eternity, amen, and not really having works that you have what accumulated in this life that's not of gold, silver, and precious stones. You want to be able to serve the Lord willingly, and you want to be in roles and positions of responsibility. And in order to be in positions and roles of responsibility, then your faithfulness and your commitment and the probation period that we are presently engaged in is what God is looking for to determine your nature, character, and your attitude or personality. That's what God is going to look at. How he that is faithful in the least will be what? Faithful in that which is what? A whole lot. Okay. So he that does not value and that's not faithful in things which pertains to others, then who could trust that person with what? True responsibilities throughout eternity. See, God is seeking, the Bible says his eyes are what? Running to and fro throughout the whole earth. And he's looking for those hearts that's what? Perfect before him. Okay, now I've said a whole lot tonight, but all in a nutshell, just start talking to some folks and get them in place where they can hear the word. And after they hear the word, then you what? Keep encouraging them to come and to be faithful and committed to what? To Bible study, so that they can grow and they can fulfill the call that God has placed on all of our lives. And the call is this: go into all of the world and what? Preach the gospel. And basically is to share your experience, amen, with people, what God has done for you. Amen. And I believe if we did that, I believe that this place would what? Fill up. It would fill up. So we're going to see some movement next month, all right? We're going to see some movement. We're already beginning to see some movement. All right, so let's all stand. We just wanted to kind of get that. So happy to have a precious sister tonight. I don't know who she is, but she's very attentive. Wish we had more like that. We're so happy to have you tonight.
And thank you. That's my friend,
Pastor. Oh, really?
That's my friend,
Pastor.
She came once before.
Okay.
She asked if she could join us tonight.
Oh, yeah. All right. Well, that is good. And we're so happy tonight for the Browns and also for the Williams. Is cookies for that? Wow. Yes, all right. Sister Gaynell, we are praying that God will give you strength and he will intercede and he will take charge. Amen. So we just going to bow our heads just for a moment. How many believe it was worth coming for tonight? Amen. Father, tonight as we leave this place, we thank you for the grace of God that brings salvation. It has appeared, it has been manifested, and we have experienced the manifestation of your grace because it came and saved us and delivered us from the power of darkness. Not only has your grace saved us, but it is delivering us from the power of this present world. In other words, it's giving us the ability to overcome sin, Satan, the flesh, and the world. And also, the grace of God gives us the ability to share Christ, to minister. We call that servant grace. And Father, we thank you tonight that because of the grace of God, that you have given us the ability, Lord, to be cleansed and to be purged from our sins, to remove all of the hindrance and all of the guilt and doubt and unbelief, so that we can be zealous of good work and that we can work those works that will cause our works to be that will stand the test of fire. Father, we give you praise and the glory. We pray, Lord, that you will begin to use us individually to reach out and to get people to come and hear the word. And even we can share what the Lord has done for us. And Lord, we don't want our friends, our loved ones, and those that we have rubbed shoulders with, and those that we have known throughout our lives, we don't want them lost. Lord, use me. Use us. Give us that passion, give us that burden, restore the joy of our salvation. And Lord, and we will teach sinners your ways and sinners will be converted to you. Father, we give you praise and the glory tonight. In Jesus' name, everybody say in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, thank you, Lord. Amen, amen. Okay, those.